Thank you. Good morning. The peace of Christ be with you. Welcome to worship. Today is the first Sunday of Advent. My name is Dennis Dupree, for those that don't know me. Excuse me. And it is a joy to worship with all of you. If you are visiting, we invite you to sign the guest book or complete a pew envelope. We would love to connect with you. If you are on Zoom or watching the recorded video, we are thankful to worship with you. Advent is a season of preparation. As we settle in from the morning, let us intentionally set our hearts and minds on worshiping God as we listen to the prelude.
Good morning. Watch and wait for Christ's coming, like candles of hope, peace, joy, and love. Remembering the promises of God with prayer, we light this candle in hope. The story begins with hope for a child. A child who will lead us. A child who will be our living hope. Let us worship God. Mm-hmm.
Please join with me in the call to worship. It is the beautiful task of Advent to awaken in all of us memories of goodness and thus to open doors of hope. When you have ears to hear,
eyes to see, you will recognize him in any moment of your life.
Life is Advent.
Life is recognizing the coming of the Lord.
Please join in singing song, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. It's on page 2 in your hymnal. Realignment, confession. God, these are darkening days with little hope in sight. Help us in our fear and exhaustion. Anchor us in hope. Blessed are we with eyes open to see the accumulated suffering of danger, sickness, and loneliness, the injustice of racial oppression, the unimpeded greed, and the misuse of power. Violence, intimidation, and the use of dominance for its own sake, the mockery of truth, and disdain for weakness or vulnerability, and worse, the seeming powerlessness of anyone trying to stop it. Let us pray together. God, seek us out and find us, we your tired people, and lead us out to where our home is, where your kingdom will come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Fill me with your grace, I'll be with your God, glorify me with your hope.
Open your hands as you release your prayers. Then take hold of hope as a protest, the assurance of pardon. For within you, Jesus, we can hold hope, we can be given strength, and we are forgiven. Amen.
Oh,
Our scripture reading this morning is taken from Mark 1, verses 1 through 11. It can be found on page 812 of your Pew Bible. This is the beginning of the good news about Jesus the Messiah, the Son of God. Long ago, Isaiah the prophet wrote, "I will send my messenger ahead of you. He will prepare your way. A messenger is calling out in the desert, 'Prepare the way of the Lord, make straight paths for him.'" And so John the Baptist appeared in the desert. He preached that people should be baptized and turned away from their sins. Then God would forgive them. All the people from the countryside of Judea went out to him, and all the people from Jerusalem went too. When they admitted they had sinned, John baptized them in the Jordan River. John wore clothes made out of camel's hair, and he had a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. Here is what John was preaching. "After me, there is someone coming who is more powerful than I am. I'm not good enough to bend down and untie his sandals. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee. John baptized Jesus in the Jordan River. Jesus was coming out of the water. Just then, he saw heaven being torn open. Jesus saw the Holy Spirit coming down on him like a dove. A voice spoke to him from heaven. It said, "You are my son, and I love you. I am very pleased with you."
The word of God for the people of God. It is a joy to be with you all here on the first Sunday of Advent. The greens have been hung. Yes, I am sporting a new stole. The choir has changed to Advent colors as well. The season of Advent is here. It's interesting that the lectionary starts us with the story of John the Baptism and or John the Baptizer and Jesus's baptism. Or at least that was my thoughts when I first read this scripture reading for today. It's strange to start there at my first read, right? This is not the birth story of Jesus that we hear in Matthew. It is not the birth story of John the Baptist that we get in Luke, and it is not the beginning of time like we get in John. Now, Mark, our scripture reading today, is written in such a direct and concise way, it's easy to miss that first line, or at least I did. The Mark 1, verse 1, this is the beginning of good news about Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God. Today's scripture reading that was read is a story of new hope, of a new beginning that comes with baptism. We have a Messiah. I want to point out that verses 2 and 3 immediately goes from, here's the good news. This is what was prophesied, referencing Malachi and Isaiah. Verse 3, and this is how it happened. So let me tell you about John. And in it goes into how, right, I will send my messenger ahead of you. He will prepare the way. And we are in that same season of preparing for Jesus's birth. So there is within this story of newness, and it is hope found in an unexpected place, in a crazy-looking man named John, who was baptizing crowds of people in the river. Met by Jesus, who God's voice comes down, "This is my son." Wow. Can you imagine witnessing that and the hope that may come from that very moment of baptism? See, God has a way of doing that, of showing up in unexpected ways. So I have this this story recently. The kids come home with lots and lots of papers, right? Coloring sheets, worksheets, assessments. It's always a stack, and we're always sorting. Keep and recycle and hang on the fridge, right? And one of the papers was an assessment where the task was, there were uppercase and lowercase letters, and each letter that was named incorrectly, so the teacher would point and my child would say, name that letter, the teacher would write what was spoken and said. So you would get the typical, the common mistakes of the D's and the B's mixed up, right? And then came to the lowercase T, and her teacher wrote, this is a cross. My sweet pea didn't see that as a lowercase T, but a cross. She's not wrong. It is an example that I have sat with this week and meditated with as I've read this scripture that has brought me joy, because what it shows me is how Christ can show up in unexpected places. There are times and situations where the world will say again and again and again, that is just a T, just a T, just a T. This is exactly how it's going to play out. And there are times where we can look at a situation, and if we are holding hope, we can see that a little differently. We can see Christ there. We can see the cross there. We can see the new beginnings that we have in God. And so from our scripture reading, we have John the Baptist speaking about good news and what is to come. He is seeing things differently. Let me paint the picture a little bit of the cultural and historical components of this time. So this was about somewhere between 66 and 70 CE. This is a time when John the Baptist is speaking to the people about the good news. There is a significant war. Some radical Jews have revolted against Rome. Jerusalem is under siege. Reports are that the conditions in the city are very, very bad. People are divided. Some see God raising up leaders to push those other people out, and others urge the submission to the Romans, as that must be the pathway to peace and security. Everyone is anxious and fearful. The leadership is unstable. The emperor has recently passed, and the people who are supposed to be taking over have been assassinated. The future is uncertain. Prices of food and oil have skyrocketed. And everything about what will unfold feels so unsure. Can you relate to any of those feelings? I sit in that uncomfortable place of heartache and war and divide and illness. And then my heart refocuses on line one, verse one from Mark. This is the beginning of the good news. And as I meditate on that very first line, this is the beginning of the good news, I am reminded that God's kingdom is not yet here on earth as it is in heaven. And I am reminded that this story is not over. You know, there is this place that we have, where we can encounter God and we can hold hope in that storm of unknowns. You all chuckled when I said, could you relate, right? because we struggle with illness. We struggle with death. We struggle with frustrations and people and that other group and those guys and these gals, and war rages on. And we are to hold hope, knowing that God is not done. I had this incredibly powerful encounter with God that gave me great hope in an unknown situation. A little bit of a backstory. My grandfather lived well into his 90s. He had congestive heart failure, and in those last 5 years, it wasn't uncommon for him to be hospitalized for a period of time while we readjusted medications to get the levels where he could breathe easy and his heart could do what it needed to do. And it was one of those times that he had been hospitalized, and I went in to go visit him, and I sat by his bedside, and I could tell he was worried, so I started telling him about my day. I started telling him about work and the family and the house. And my grandfather was in the school system in a time where everything was memorized. So he had his books and his stories and his poems that he knew by heart. And that's the way he loved to do it. And so even well into his 90s, he would challenge himself with memorizing new poems and stories. So he was, I say all that to say, he was always singing a tune or reciting a poem. And I sat there thinking I was helping him, and he interrupted my story singing, "Hey, sirrah, sirrah, whatever will be." You know that. And so I sat and I listened, and he finished, and I started my story again. And still, Grandpa had the audacity to interrupt my story again. "Hey, sirrah, sirrah, whatever will be, will be." And I paused. And yep, I was that grandchild who did it the third round, started again. And he smiled at me with a twinkle in his eye, and I laughed, and I held his hand, and together we began to sing. It was in that moment that I realized that my grandfather's anxiety didn't need distraction, but he needed somebody to hold his hand, knowing that how that future moment, how that hospitalization visit was going to unfold was unknown. But he needed hope and he needed peace that whatever unfolded from that moment was gonna be okay. You know, it was years later that I say that a lot because really I felt this call to become a minister when I was 13, and I am 36, so I avoided it for a long time and wrestled with it in a lot of different ways. One night was in prayer. This is after my grandfather had passed. And I was praying to God, wrestling with this call of stepping further into ministry and to begin my school program. And I was anxious and fearful and uncertain. Some of those same emotions that we talked about just a few minutes ago. And I began to cry out to the Lord because I was super stressed about it. "Lord, I know you are calling me, but I just don't see how. I just don't see how this is going to work. I don't know how. I want a family. How do I start a family and do this? How? I don't want to have to move. There's probably not a church who would want me nearby." God provides. Oh. And as I sat in prayer, I could see myself standing in a field with tall grass and fog. Can you picture it? I can see my feet in my area, but I can't see beyond this one moment. And I stood there in the grass, and there came the words of my grandfather. "Hey, sirrah, sirrah, whatever will be. Future's not ours to see. Hey, sirrah, sirrah." And it was in that moment that I was flooded with hope. Hope that though I could not see beyond my arm's reach, that God would provide a way. Hope that God would walk with me through that time. Hope that though it was unseen, that God could see it. That is hope. That is God with us. Friends, we know that Jesus came born to us in a manger. And we know that John comes out into the wilderness crying, "Prepare a way for the Lord, make your paths straight." John prepares the people for Jesus, and Jesus comes to baptize us with the Holy Spirit. God with us. O come, Emmanuel. Circling back to the people of this time, they faced great hardships and darkness. And I know we too sit in our own darkness. And our darkness can take many shapes: loss and illness and disease, poverty and war. And when those hardships come into our lives, it is normal to pull in, to grieve, to be sad, to pull the covers over your head to rest. And yet, just like Jesus' baptism, the story was not done. Just like my prayer moment with God, it did not end there. I know that God is not done. Friends, there is more work, more change, more healing, more peace, more justice to be done on this earth. And friends, as we wait for that to unfold, may we hear the good news that Christ, the Messiah, is coming. May we make our paths straight. May we hold hope for what is to come. Thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Barbara Brown Taylor, who is a well-known author and Episcopal priest, says this: whether it is a seed in the ground, a baby in the womb, or Jesus in the tomb, it all starts in the dark. And new life is coming. We have heard how God busts into this world in unimaginable ways, parting seas, feeding thousands, walking on water, born in a manger to a teen mother, to flee being a refugee due to extreme violence. Friends, there are unknowns and mysteries in this world, but it is in those places I invite you to hold hope. Hold hope in Almighty God that this story, your story, is not over yet. If you can't hold hope, please hold someone's hand who can hold hope. Advent is the time that we are reminded to hold hope for what is coming. Emmanuel, God with us. And let us listen to those words of John the Baptist. Prepare the way. Focus our hearts, making our paths straight. And know and be at peace, knowing that the God of hope is near. You pray with me. Holy One, we carry so much. And as we carry so much, it is hard to walk in your way of faith and trust. And we stumble this way and that. Lord, I ask that you help us to lay those things down. When the world says no way, may we say Yahweh, God's way. God, you are the provider. You give us hope. You are with the seed in the dark soil, the baby in the womb, and Jesus in the tomb. The story is not over. And so, Lord, we lay down our burdens and we choose to pick up hope. And we will carry hope into this world, sharing it with each other and everyone. Amen. Will you join me in singing "Lift Up Your Heads, Ye Mighty Gates," page 8. Time for our joys and concerns and announcements. Both Dennis and I have microphones. This helps those who are joining us via Zoom to hear. I'll start with an announcement. We are beginning today an Advent study. This has been emailed out, but I also have hard copies available and am happy to make more if we need them. There's some on this table as you walk out into the fellowship hall. Group study options are Tuesday morning at 9:30 or Thursday nights at 7 on Zoom. So Lord, may God bless that gathering. Anyone on Zoom?
Hi, Whitney. It's Michelle.
Hi, Michelle.
I'm asking for continued prayers for two friends that are struggling right now with health challenges. Their names are Barb and Christine.
Thank you. Absolutely. Lord, we lift Barb and Christy to you. Lord, provide healing, provide a way, provide medical wisdom. Any other things today?
I had surgery 10 days ago, and I'm doing pretty good. And I'd like to thank everybody from the church. I got a lot of cards, a lot of prayers, a lot of phone calls, so I'm really happy for everybody. Thank you so much.
We are happy for you. Joy, thanks be to God for a recovery. Not an easy procedure.
I'm extremely thankful to have my husband, Ken, with me.
Thanks be to God. It is a joy to have you here. All righty. Holy One, we lift the prayers spoken and unspoken. We lift the ministries and activities of this church to you. May you bless them. May everything that happened be pleasing to your ears. Be with us next week as we do the pageant and then our Christmas party and then Christmas Eve. Lord, thank you for holding hope, for being a beacon of hope. Thank you for the fact that the story is not over and that, God, you are not done. Holy One, we lift the things that sit on our hearts to you now and pray as you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We'll take this time for our offering. And I want to remind all of us that in this season of hope, we can give hope and offer hope to God in so many ways. By the acts of our hands and our hearts and in our gifts. And thanks be to God for that. Dedication. Holy One, this Advent season, we wait in hope and we give in hope. Hope for the coming rain, Hope because your presence with us even now. Receive these generous offerings and use them for your work of healing and hope in our world. Amen. Friends, this is the hopeful feast of the people of God. People will come from the east and the west and the north and the south to sit at this table of the kingdom of God. Friends, the God who came to us from the darkness of his mother's womb meets us here. This table is deep and wide. All are welcome here. You are welcome to meet the Lord Jesus Christ here at this table. The Lord be with you. We lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. God is with us, friends. We are not alone. Christ is present here with us. The Spirit moves within us, and though we take this moment to remember the God of hope that came from a young mother named Mary. God came to her and said, "You will be with child, and you will name him Jesus, and he will change the world." And as we prepare for Jesus' birth in this Advent season, we echo that same cry of, O come, Emmanuel. And even now, though we prepare to celebrate Jesus' birth, we remember his life. We remember his baptism and his death and his resurrection. And we remember how he came together and sat with people at the table, breaking bonds of tradition. He sat with those who were despised and the outcasts. He broke down those barriers. And so today, we remember how he gathered his friends in the upper room, and after supper, he prepared them. And he took bread, and he blessed it, and he broke it, saying, "This is my body broken for you. Take of it and eat it, and do this in remembrance of me." Jesus took the cup and poured it, blessing it, saying, "This cup is a sign of a new covenant sealed in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. Drink of it, all of you. The God of hope will come again. Drink of it and remember me." My ushers, come forward. The table is ready.
Thank you.
Christ said, "I am the bread of life. Whoever believeth in me will have eternal life." Jesus said, "I am the vine and you are the branches. Abide in me and I in you, and all things are possible." Let's pray together. God of pregnant expectations, God of Christmas promises, God of childlike hope, we have eaten and drunk from your table. May the eating and drinking fill us with hope in this world. May we be beacons of hope, filled with your hope going from this place, shining your hope as we wait for the day when the world will be changed forever. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Friends, in response to today's service, let's sing our closing hymn, number 9, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. For you, verse 2, as some parting words. Disperse the gloomy clouds of night and death's dark shadows put to flight. Friends, it is in Christ that we have new life. It is in Christ that darkness is put to flight. To rejoice, be beacons of hope in your home, be beacons of hope in this church and in this community. Go forth with the peace of Christ with you. You are not alone. Amen.